and praise the Lord, dear friends. It's my joy to introduce to all of you our guest speaker for today. She is one of the most renowned, most loved and most admired English educator of our town, and she is none other than Ma'am Jaya Arun. And it's my privilege to have conversation with her and to learn from her so many things which you are about to hear. So let me give you a brief introduction about Ma'am Jaya, though any number of words will be less to introduce her because such a magnificent personality she is. So Ma'am Jaya was born and brought up in Coimbatore. She had done her 10th standard from Bombay and 12th standard from Coimbatore, and she has finished her MA B.Ed. from Hyderabad Central University. Later on, she joined SOFIA in 1996 and left SOFIA in 2010. And it was not a simple or normal leaving, it was a leaving with a legacy over there. On behalf of all of you, I welcome Ma'am Jaya and I thank her for taking out time for all of us from her busy schedule and sharing and conferring on us her words of wisdom. Thank you and welcome to this beautiful conversation. So once again, I welcome one of the most celebrated English teacher, educator of our town. And it's a real privilege of me to be here with Ma'am Jaya. I know Ma'am Jaya from so long and already I have told you in the introduction. So I welcome you, ma'am, once again. And I firmly believe that all the students and all those who are watching this video, they will be absolutely delighted. And lots of memories must be rushing through their minds right now. So I welcome you,
thank
ma'am.
Thank you so much.
And it's my privilege. And I thank you.
Welcome.
It's my privilege that you have taken time out of your busy schedule to address all the students, very especially in this time of pandemic. So I thank you and I welcome you once again.
Thank you, Piyush. And I'd like to say here that being a teacher is such a big part of my identity that there was no question of not doing this. It would be great to reach so many of my students. Many are in touch. But yes, it would be good to think of all those past days and talk to you about it. So thank you for this opportunity.
Okay, thank you, ma'am. So let's start our session for today. And ma'am, my first question to you will be, you have been teaching since a long time. How has your journey been? And can you share an experience which reaffirms your pride in being a teacher?
Yeah, this journey has been long and fortunately very, very happy. There have been a lot of ups, a few downs, which, you know, when you look over the years, they don't really count. So it's been a wonderful experience, wonderful journey. And I would be hard put to be able to share just one experience. There are so many experiences crowding in my mind now. I'll just give you a little bit of a background. I started teaching with a lot of doubts in my mind. I was always a very shy person. It may not seem so right now, but I had always been on the other side of the classroom, you know, as from now. And I was not sure that I would be able to teach or, you know, do anything like that. There was absolutely no other option in Bhilwara at that time. I'm talking about 1985. So my career started very nervously. But within a few months, I was very fortunate to have found my vocation. So this is one of those times when, you know, I'm one of those very lucky few people whose profession is the same as their vocation. That is what I would like to say, and I hope it doesn't sound immodest. So that is why this journey has been wonderful. What makes me feel very contented, very satisfied about this journey is that I have been able to interact with students and see the differences that have come about in their lives, you know, the way they have grown. Like I said, I've been teaching in only one place for a very long time, and it is a very joyful experience to find ex-students bringing their children to me for coaching, you know. And it becomes even better when I remember that these children who are bringing their children along are the ones who used to get a lot of scoldings in class. You know, I used to feel that you are not making use of your potential. Do more. And, you know, it's gone in somewhere. It's soaked in. And now they come back. And they want the same experience with their children also. Another thing is, at this point of time, I think many, many of my students have become my teachers now. I want to read a particular book, I go to a student's blog to find out what she says about it. You know, I want to bake something, cook something, there are children there who are doing it. I want to give an example of a really good homemaker or a mother, and there they are. You know, teachers, again, there are. So this has made my journey wonderful.
Yes, very true. And since I got the privilege to work with you, I know this very well. The footprints that you have left, they are still fresh in the memories, in the mind. It's not that ki ma'am Jaya taught us so long, yeah, long back, but I can very well say that they are really very, very fresh. Thank you, ma'am. So my second question to you is, having been a teacher for so many years, you have taught many things to many children and molded so many lives. Has it also been a learning experience for you? Do share.
Yes, I would say that it has been a two-way street. If I have, as you very nicely put it, molded them, then they also have taught me a number of lessons. And maybe today I am a better person, I hope, because of their inputs. A few lessons that they have taught me, one of them being the most important is, I realized after teaching for a few years that it does not matter what a child is in class. You know, we may think that, okay, she's getting this average marks. I may even have got angry with her, you know, you're not trying your best and all that. But I've seen now that it may be because the child is not interested in that particular subject. It may be because I have not been able to awaken that interest in that particular child. It may be there's some illness at home, some problems, whatever it is, you know. That may be the reason that the child gets average marks. Those same girls, it's been such a wonderful experience that it's those same girls 10 years later, 15 years later, they're running their own businesses. They are at the top of their professions. They are respected. They are very good homemakers. They have wonderfully well-behaved children. So this is a big lesson that these children have taught me, that in the classroom only, you know, it's there is more to us. That is one. Then I remember there was one child, this was I think somewhere in, may have been around 2000 or so. One day she just got up and said, ma'am, there's one question I want to ask you. And that is, every day when I go home, I can tell my mother that my friend's mother sent a wonderful tiffin. You know, it was very tasty. Why can't you cook like that? But she said, I never do that. Because I take it, okay, you know, this is my mother, this is what she makes, and fine, no problems. And she said, every day almost, my mother tells me, why can't you behave like so and so? You know, why don't you study as much as so and so? So she said, why do parents keep on comparing? And she said, we don't compare. So I said, yes, as adults, I do not think I was guilty of that sin much. But after that, you know, it made me aware. And whether it was at home or whether it was in class, I took good care not to compare. So these, I think, have been major takeaways for me.
Yeah, that's very true. This is one thing I also learned in my life, and I very especially do give in my parenting sessions, that if one day they get a chance to tell you that why you are not as rich as my friend's father is, you know how heartbreaking be it. This dialogue will be for you. So very true, very wisely said, ma'am. This comparison is really killing lots and lots of potential in the children. Very true.
That's true. Very true.
Thank you. So next question is, ma'am, what is the biggest challenge facing the present generation in your opinion? And what are your suggestions to the young people on dealing with it?
Unfortunately, there isn't just one big challenge. And over the past year and a half, I think there have been any number of challenges. And my sympathies are all with the youngsters now, you know, who physically also they have so much energy. They want to go out. They want to do things. They're not able to do it. Online classes may or may not be everybody's cup of tea. It's very difficult. But one challenge that I would like to talk about is a challenge which has been there for quite some time now. And that is mediocrity. You know, the reinforcement of mediocrity. And this I've been noticing for a long time now, and especially with all these reality shows where children come and sing and dance, and you can make out that they're doing a really bad job. And inside they probably know that we are not doing as well as we were doing earlier. But there's always some misguided judge who says, oh, it's awesome. You know, and immediately in that 1 second, you passed on the message from that adult to the youngster, ki sab chalta hai. You just do whatever is, you know, you are in the mood for. And that is fine, because somebody or the other is going to clap and say, oh, wonderful. Right? So this kind of mediocrity, I think, is encouraged, one, by people like this, who are never going to meet those contestants later on. Also, maybe by parents who don't want to discourage their children. So when the child writes 4 lines and there are 40 mistakes, you know, you say, wow, wonderful, right? It could be teachers who are so fed up of doing the same thing over and over again. They say, ah, beta, wonderful. Okay, let's go on to the next. So I don't know from how many sources this mediocrity comes in, but that I feel is a very big thing. Another thing is there are so many distractions, you know, phones and, I mean, the ones, my students or ex-students who will be listening to this will know those distractions better than I do, right? And another one that I feel again is a very big challenge is the E word, that is expectations. Expectations from parents that a child who has been doing badly in English till the 10th should suddenly become a best-selling author, right? That somebody who doesn't immediately cannot even tell somebody what 15 times 5 is should be an engineer immediately, should get into the IITs. And the expectation of the youth that every single person should be earning in crores. You know, I had this boy come to me once and he said, I want to learn English because I want to get rich quick. Those were the ways it shocked me. But that is the way he presented himself, you know. So these are, according to me, the biggest challenges. My suggestions would be that for the distractions, you know, like I'm not talking about very young children who will not know the difference. But surely somebody who is 14, 15, 17, 18 will know that if he or she spends 3 hours on the phone, it's not a good thing. Also, at that age, you are aware. That's why when children come out of the examination hall, very often they can tell you, sir, paper didn't go as well as I wanted it to. Never mind if they get 95 in that paper later on. Right? So know yourself. Know yourself, know how good you are, know your weaknesses and work at them. You know, work really, really hard. Because nothing comes easy. I mean, Piyush, you know it, I know it, that nothing drops into the lab. And if at all something ever drops in like that, it's fleeting. Within days, if we are lucky, but otherwise within minutes, that is gone. So I would definitely say work hard, know yourself. Class 12 students will be doing poems. A whole poem which tells about the value of introspection, why we should introspect. So pay attention. Literature, after all, is a mirror of whatever is going on in life. Right? It's not the poem is here, life is here, and there is no match between the two. It's not like that. And for the expectation one, very difficult, but not impossible to get through it. And I feel communication should be the way. You know, communication between parents and children, maybe between one friend and another, but there has to be, this has to come out that, you know, okay, you may feel, ma or dad, that I am absolutely the cat's whiskers, but it's not like that. I am average in this particular thing, but I would like to do that. You know, this is a general thing. Each family will have their own solutions, and some of them may not match what we feel, because what we are giving is ideal solutions. But this is it. And here I would like to say, Piyush, that all through my couple of decades in Sofia, I never spoke in Hindi in class because I was an English teacher. But there was one sentence which I always used to say in Hindi, and that was, Shareer ko kasht do. Do not expect that things will come walking to you and, you know, books will open, minds will open and knowledge will get transferred. No. Pull your hair, fill in all those 10-20 notebooks, and then yes, you will be somewhere. So.
Thank you very much. It's really, you know, as you are talking, you know, so many memories are coming to me of Sofia when we used to work together. And one thing I really want to share and I really want to confess is that I have always admired you for one reason, one very, very important reason. You had always been straightforward. You are not a kind of person who is going to do little butter polish, kya lagega, and all those kind of things. This is something I have learned from you, that this is what I am and this is what I feel. So, you know, rather than pleasing others, this is my stand. And I think all the students, not only me, all the students, you know, whom you taught, I think this is one quality they all have learned from you, that this is what I am. True, if you want to listen, very good, don't want, no issues. But that really means I'm very happy. And I know that when this video, these all they are going to watch, you know, they'll be really delighted and they are going to learn a lot of things. So thank you, ma'am.
Thank you, Piyush, for this. And I just like to add one more thing. You asked me about what I've learned from the children. This is also something I learned right in the beginning, that when you're sincere in the classroom, even if you're not able to give 100% for whatever reason, but when the children know that you're making an effort, definitely they respect that. I mean, like, I may have all the knowledge in the world, but if I'm not sincere about my passing it on, then somewhere or the other, children realize it, you know. So they have encouraged this in me, that be frank, be open, teach what you know, and that's it. And there's one more thing I'd like to say regarding this suggestions and this question. That is, you know, when one is at this stage, when you're 17, 18, getting admission into a particular college, doing a particular course becomes the most important thing in the world. And everybody can't get it. Some with brains and luck will manage to get what they want. Others will not. But I'd like to reassure everybody who's listening to us that it doesn't really matter. In 10 years, 15 years, what really matters is how you did your job, whatever it may be. What the job is does not matter.
Very true. That's very wisely said, ma'am. Great. So next question is, ma'am, we all have a role model who inspired us to be what we are today. So we would be extremely delighted to hear about your role model?
Now, this is a question I think I shall have to divide into three parts to deal with. You asked me about my role models, I'll tell you that. But first, I think I have to bring a doubt out in the open. And that is sometimes, you know, when I look at certain children, I wonder whether we have not done such a good job of being role models as our parents did. You know, our parents did not have to sit us down and tell us, do this or don't do this. Somewhere along the way, I think many of us have forgotten that, you know, in the race maybe to earn or to give more and more to the children or whatever. So this is something that all we have to think about, and also children who are listening to us, in the future they have to keep this in mind. Another thing about these role models is, as a teacher, you know this. Somebody who does not even spell, you know, science properly. Who's your role model? Kalpana Chawla. Now, the thing is, this brings me back to the earlier one. Have role models. Have a number of role models. Learn from life as you go on. Do not choose the farthest role model that you can and then spend each day of your life thinking, oh, I'm not good enough. Oh, I'm not good enough. You know, one has got to be a little more practical, a little more, enlightened about this, that among all the people who want to be a particular thing, only one may or may not succeed. You know, everybody is fond of movies. There can be only one Amitabh, or there can be only one Dilip Kumar. God knows how many lakhs of people lost their whole lives wanting to be that. So choose your role model with care. Go beyond that role model if possible. But do not, you know, waste time thinking that I can't do what is anyway impossible. Yeah, now coming to my role models. I come from a family full of readers, and everybody can speak a minimum of 4 languages. So this was the input that I had right from the beginning. In fact, when anybody would drop in unannounced, and if they were not readers, they would be very irritated to find my grandparents, my parents, we siblings, and you know, anybody else who was around there, each in their favorite chair or corner, blissfully reading, not concerned with what is happening in the other places. So that was a very big role model for me, because I have grown up reading, and I feel that reading is the most important thing. Those who are listening, especially my earlier students, you know, till about 2002-2003, when, you know, classes were still manageable, the number, they will know, some of them will give me credit for their love of books, and some of them will definitely want to throw something at me, still talking the same things. So that was one. I also learned a lot from every language teacher. I had 3 languages in school, English, Hindi and Marathi. And then the last 2 years of school, that is 9th and 10th, I also did French. All the teachers were good. And all of them, now that I think of it, all of them were like me when it comes to getting irritated, because the children always wanted to study maths or geography or something else, but not English, Hindi or Marathi. But they were all good at their work. They tried their best in spite of blank faces in front of them, like we often do, Piyush. And that's it. It gave me a lot of, knowledge, and I enjoyed their classes. I've also learned from characters in books. You know, if I come across a good character and I want to be like him or her, that gives me the impetus. Friends who have either shown me a new way, or told me very softly, better not go this side, do something else that way. And one more point I'd like to make is, role models are not always positive. I mean, that's the way I see it. I've also come across people who, you know, for some, it may be politically incorrect to say things like that, but I cannot stand those people. And immediately I've made a mental note, I should not be like this person. That also works. It's not only I should be like so and so, but also I should not be like so and so.
Yeah, that's both the ways. That's very true. Yes. Good. Great. So it's like a stream of wisdom is going on.
Oh, Piyush, go slow.
No, really, really, I'm telling you. Okay. So, what sort of a student were you? What were your interests? And was it always your ambition to become a teacher?
As a student, I think I was very boring. I was very good academically. I was always tall, so always sat on the last bench and always got the first rank.
Okay.
I'm sure it irritated any number of people. I went to a school in Mumbai, Goregaon, and even at that time, in the late 70s, there were 55 to 60 children in each class. So there wasn't much of a question of extracurricular activities or co-curricular activities and all that. There were a few, but I was totally into reading, you know, and because I'd been reading right from, I think, when I was 5 or so. And I was reading pretty heavy stuff by the time I was 15, 16. One thing I would like to say is that I was always good at languages. I worked hard at them. I also did my best with science and maths. I did not enjoy it in the least. I do not enjoy them now also. But at that time, I had that much sense that even if I don't enjoy this, I have to study. But
beautiful.
I would like to say one more thing, which is hindsight now. And that is, I would encourage, in fact, I would request each child to study all the subjects, you know, properly, practically, try to get them clear in their minds till the 10th. After the 10th, yes, you go on your own way. But there are so many principles and concepts in maths and science, which I remembered only till the day of the last board exam. And then immediately I forgot them. Please don't do that. All those who are listening, all those who are, you know, who have growing children, make them understand that yes, there will always be certain things you like and certain you don't like. But pay attention, at least till the 10th, to all the subjects.
That's a great piece of advice, actually.
You asked what my interests were. I think it was reading all through. I like writing. I liked it then also. I used to write on and off, nothing very great or something like that, but yeah, I did put in whatever I felt. No, like most people, I did not want to be a teacher. The main thing was that since I was shy, I had never ever taken part in any elocutions or any recitations, because the very thought of so many faces looking at me was intolerable.
It's too really hard to believe, actually.
Yes. For which I must thank all the children who looked, particularly the children who looked at me like that. Ki kya hai? So I tried my best to make them more and more interested. And finally, I got to a point where I wasn't conscious anymore in front of students. So yeah, I did not really think of becoming a teacher, but I was also lucky to be growing up in a time where people didn't really ask us, what do you want to be? What is your ambition? So my ambition in life was mainly to read more and more and more books. If I keep getting books, that is all I wanted. Somewhere along the way, other things happened, I got married, came to Bhilwara. I wanted to work. There was absolutely no option other than being a teacher. So the choice was only stay at home or be a teacher. And I went. The principal, Mr. N.C. Sharma, my first principal that way, was very broad-minded. And he was one of those, you know, everything was part of his knowledge, you know. And any word I use, if he was not very sure, immediately you take out a dictionary and say, oh. So it gave me a good start. I felt comfortable in that. So this was, by the way, Vidyaniketan in 1985.
Okay.
Which was where now you have this landmark hotel. It was in that.
Okay.
It was a very different kind of a school. Few students, lots of leeway. So that's where I honed my skills of storytelling and humor and, you know, and speaking in Hindi outside, but not in class. Children were horrified.
Yeah, yeah.
English teacher doesn't know Hindi. What is this? So yeah, it happened like that. And okay, Piyush, there's one more thing I'd love to share. You know, when we used to have these talks with children, class 10, class 12 and all that, there never used to be a single child who'd say, I want to become a teacher. You know,
and I would always, it's still the same.
Yeah, I would always smile at them. Also, remember those April end wali classes when it used to be so hot and they used to look like this. And sometimes I used to have the last period. And I used to tell them, you know, I said, one day, at least five of you are going to stand on the other side of the classroom and you're going to have 50 faces looking at you the same way. Whenever that happens, think of me. And the funny thing is that some children did actually call back and tell me that, ma'am, I'm a teacher and I understand very well now because I'm facing those blank faces.
Yeah, that's true. That's true.
So, there are very, very, very few children, I think, who start by thinking that, you know, I'm going to be a teacher. But many do a very, very good job. And, you know, like, I'm really proud of all those kids. Maybe I shouldn't be saying kids, young ladies who have, you know. So, it was not an ambition of mine, but I think I'll not be wrong in saying that it is a part of me that gives me great satisfaction.
So somehow it was a divine plan. So that's how you, it was absolutely a divine plan.
Yes.
Good. So now something really great, and you know, so you spent close to two decades teaching in Sofia. Any funny experience that you remember from your period over there? Before you share, I would love to share. I do not know you remember or not. When I had joined Sofia, no, very often I used to hear from students, BJP, BJP, BJP. And I was really like, no, I was baffled that so often when they used to see us, no, here and there, and somehow you can hear it. After a long time, I had come to know BJP was Batul Jaya Piyush. Anyway,
yeah, actually, I think we both also enjoyed the fact that we could cross over to a little bit, you know, other than the fact that we got along in everything else. I mean, you're so much younger, almost like a son, and it was easy, you know, and you had this fresher look, the viewpoint, you know, because we were already older. And children related to us in a different manner.
Yeah.
And when they related to you in a different way, you'd say, okay, this way, oh, they think like this now. This generation is like this.
Yeah.
So you also have been, you know, one of those sources which have taught me a few things about these younger kids. Sofia, for the most part, was a very satisfying experience. And yeah, every year something or the other used to come up that was funny. I'd like to, you know, talk about these moments as the funny haha moment and the funny strange moment. Let me start with the funny strange moment. right in the beginning, you know, within the first 4-5 years of my teaching there, I had this tremendous zeal to improve situations. And I was probably too young to realize that changes can be brought about, but very, very slowly. So there was this child who wouldn't utter a word, not just in English, but not even in Hindi. And I was very worried about her. And once when the father came, and parents came to the meeting, they came and asked me any problems and all that. So against better judgment, somehow that day I opened up. I told them, look, what I feel is that this child will really benefit if she goes to a Hindi medium school. Because she'll be able to understand everything and she'll be able to write everything. English will be just one subject. I'd seen some other children do very well in other schools like that. Sophia's a guy and they managed it. So the parents looked at each other, they and all that. Then finally the mother told me, nahi ma'am, actually problem is ki if the girl is from Sophia, we won't have any problem marrying her off. Because they will. And she said, ki all of you teachers have been speaking in English all the time. So, jab uspe, you know, when it will fall upon her to speak in English, I think she'll do it. Shocked. Even more shocked when after the board exams, they specially came to meet me. English, 75 marks.
Yeah, so that is very generous.
That is when all my seniors told me, now enough, don't try to advise, but this is it. So this was one of those strange moments. Another couple of moments where I think Ma'am Batul also will remember was when, you know, I was telling somebody that your child has a lot of potential. You know, you should encourage her more, but she doesn't seem to be paying attention and all. And the father ups and says, do you know? At 10 moments notice, she can cook for 6 people and she's only in the 10th. Okay, what is this? So, you know, these kind of funny, strange moments have been sort of the spice in the regular academic year. But the funny haha moment that I had, this was soon after joining school, I think maybe 93, 94. And that has still remained at the top of this course. I was my written Hindi has always been good, but I was always slightly hesitant about speaking in Hindi. And as an English teacher, there was no way I would be seen even dead speaking Hindi. So I spoke only in English. Now after the year and a half almost, a number of us had taken these 8th, 9th and 10th girls to Jaipur on some educational tour. And we were sitting in the front, all the teachers. And we were talking in Hindi. And you know, I answered something to somebody sitting a little further away. And there's this sudden silence at the back of the bus, you know, and then one whispering going on. And just then the driver stopped, ki chalo everybody get down for a little while. And there are these little knots of children, and finally some of them came up to me and said, you know Hindi? So, and I said, yeah.
So that must be a strange for that.
You know English. So the looks on their faces, you know, when I'm recounting it now, it doesn't sound all that funny. But the looks on their faces, and then I thought, how much they must have been dropping their secrets. Because inko to aati nahi Hindi.
Ah, that's true. That's true. Good, really. I still remember. Means, you know, when we are talking, you know, all those memories of the staff room when we used to enjoy the, you know, corridor chit chat. This all is coming to my mind. All becoming alive and fresh. Those were really days. We really enjoyed a lot.
Really, yes. I really miss those.
Yeah, great. So as we come to end of this beautiful conversation, one question which is must for this conversation. So I'm sure you're often asked this question. However, I would like to ask you this once again. How can one improve one's English?
Yes, I can understand why you want to ask it. You know, before I say anything about it, I have been asked this question on the railway platform, at a wedding while going up, you know, to meet the bride and groom and somebody next, ma'am, at any number of gatherings, social functions and all that, I do not mind it. Some of my friends and all used to say, you should just tell them, this is not school. Don't ask me now. But there was also this, you know, I realized that however much we may try to feel or try to, you know, say that English doesn't count, it does count. I'll also qualify this statement by saying your mother tongue also counts.
That's true.
Having spent some 30-35 years in Bhilwara, and being able to speak a little Mewari and understand a little Mewari, I still am ashamed of the fact that I cannot speak like a native.
Okay.
That is essential. But yes, English is also very important. I'd say there is no simple path towards it. You know, the only thing is read, and read more. And speak. It can't be that you will learn a language without any effort. Like I said earlier, shareer ko kasht is absolutely essential. You do what it takes. You know, nowadays there's a lot of this thing about how this teachers have to, you know, jump and dance and do this and do that so that the children will be interested. Okay, fine, do it if that is part of your method of teaching. But any student has to, you know, understand this. Education is a serious business. Education doesn't mean everything is wonderful, funny. What is so funny? There will be some things where you'll have to literally break your head over it to be able to understand. Learning language will not come easy. One has to read, one has to speak. Read every day. Do not say, I mean, till now you've not been reading at all and you pick up the fattest book that you can see and say, I'm going to read this in 3 days. That goal is not achievable. Pick up short stories, pick up short passages in the paper, read every day 10 minutes. Slowly go on to 15, 20, whatever. You know, but reading is a must. You can't do without it. The only other way I can think of to learn English is to get a one-way ticket to America or England and go and stay in a place where you have no Mewaris or Marwaris around, which is going to be difficult, but find a place like that and in 6 months you will be teaching them English. Otherwise,
that's true.
For the rest of us, read. Do not be afraid of making mistakes. You know, if you're trying to learn English, it also means that you know another couple of languages very well. And it's not just English. I would also say learn Hindi properly.
That's true.
Children, stop any kind of interaction with Hindi, that is the written word, after class 10.
Yeah.
Nobody feels bad about it. I remember asking this question to the first batch. I said, everybody's chosen English. What about Hindi? No, ma'am. No problem. The thing is, your mental Hindi level is going to remain the same.
Yeah.
The dena, jana, it's going to remain that if you don't read Hindi literature.
That's true.
So language, I'm very happy you asked me this question in spite of the realization that everybody asks this. So improve your English, improve the other language, your mother tongue also. One has got to be able to converse in both.
Good. So, ma'am, it's like I want to continue and to go on. And I really believe this is not going to be one session. I believe we will be having few more sessions, and you will have to take out some more time for all of us.
Oh, sure, sure.
But on behalf of all those who are watching and all of your students, I really extend my heartiest gratitude to you for taking out time to, you know, to confer on us. Sharing will be a small word, but I'll say to confer on us your pearls of wisdom. And we have always learned from you. We have always looked up to you, that, you know, every time we can learn something from you. So so as I talk to you, and I'm giving thanks to you, I really want to be grateful to God Almighty for gifting you to us in our lives. That's a great grace. I feel all the students, they all must be experiencing. I personally experience. So thank you very much for giving us your time and sharing, conferring your wisdom with all of us. Thank you, ma'am. God bless you.
Piyush, I'm really at a loss for words right now. I have thoroughly enjoyed this. It's a wonderful initiative that you have taken to have this series and all. And there's just one thing I would like to add. All these wonderful big words that you have, you know, given me, you know, praised me so much and all that, I'm very grateful to you that you think in such terms. But I'd also tell you to tone it down a little bit, my boy, right? I know what I am, right? So thanks anyway. But I used to tell these girls, you know, they used to do these answers, and they used to put in all these words, big words. So I always told them, you know, go slow, don't use too many of them. So there's only one condition to the next talk that we'll have, and that is you do not praise so much. Makes me uncomfortable.
That's it's very hard from my side, very tough, but I'll try my best not to praise you. I'll try my best not to praise you. But I would really like to end this conversation with one. You must not remember this, but I remember this very, very well and crystal clear. It was, I do not remember the year, but I know very well it was Diwali break. We were about, you know, Diwali break were about to start. And that day you called the entire 10th standard. It was in front of library. And you distributed them those certificates, if you remember. Simple plain A4 sheets. Simple plain A4 sheet certificates. Yes. And to every child, something or the other. Surely they must have been touched by this gesture of yours. But I am telling you, ma'am, I was deeply moved and touched by this way. So, you know, a new dimension of being an educator, you opened to me on that day. And I tell you that when I started my own, you know, teaching and all those things, you know, I did it many times, that I gave printed certificates to many of the students.
Okay.
And that is something, and they used to praise me a lot for this thing. But so those, all of the students of mine, those who used to praise me for this gesture, I am telling you, I learned it from Ma'am Jaya. She is my teacher in this. So thank you very much. But, you know, opening an absolutely new horizon of being a teacher, that in what different manner we can touch the lives of the students. So thank you very much for this great lesson that you taught me, besides all the others that I had been learning.
thank you.
So thank you very much.
Okay.
So thank you very much. God bless you and praise the Lord. Bye-bye.